Well, about, I think, 13 or so years ago, my grandmother died. Her name was Teresa Clemente, my dad's mom. And as we were at the wake, we were kind of, I think we were in the coffee room with some of my cousins, and my parents were there. And we heard this blood-curdling scream coming from, like, the general, like, wake thing area, chapel, I guess you call it. So we come running out, and there was one of my older cousins who had walked into the chapel and had seen our other cousin, Teresa, sitting in the chapel fully alive. When she had heard that Teresa died, she thought it was that Teresa, not my grandmother Teresa. And so she had thought Teresa had risen from the dead. And this scream, while we were all laughing about it, obviously, because it was very funny, but I, you know, at that time, I didn't immediately think of the resurrection, but as I would go back then in seminary and pray through this gospel, I always thought of my cousin Laura coming in and screaming because she saw Teresa alive and well sitting there in the chair at my grandmother Teresa's wake. And that's the proper reaction, right? When you see someone alive who you thought was dead. And I'm sure that was very similar to the reaction of Mary Magdalene and the other Mary and Peter and John as they got to the tomb and all the various people who will now start to see Jesus risen from the dead as we go through these Sundays of Easter and hearing all of the resurrection accounts. We don't necessarily have "ah" written in the scriptures, but I'm sure they all just kind of scream. Certainly a scream of joyfulness after they realize who he is and that everything he had said was coming true. But I'm also certain the first scream was one of fright. Not that Jesus would look like a zombie, right? This isn't a Walking Dead kind of a situation here. Rather, they don't even really recognize him at first because he's in his glorified body, which gives people like me a lot of great hope for the resurrection. There's no LA Fitnesses in heaven. I hope there's a lot of cheeseburgers and no need to exercise. Not that I exercise now, but anyway. That glorified body, they didn't recognize Jesus, right? Mary Magdalene thought he was the gardener, all right? And so it's not that he's like a zombie that makes them scream, but it's, again, they realize who he is, and they're like, aren't you supposed to be dead? See, the resurrection is life-changing, my sisters and brothers. Literally, it changes you from dead to alive. It changes your life. But then when we know and believe in the resurrection, that's also life-changing, right? The whole point of the church, as St. Paul says, is because Christ is God who leaves heaven and comes down to earth, takes on human flesh, walks our walk, talks our talk, even dies our death, so that then his followers will share in his divine life and also rise from the dead. And knowing that truth, that there will be a resurrection, that there's life eternal beyond this very temporary reality we find ourselves in, that is life-changing news. It changed Paul's life. We'll hear more of Paul as well as we go through these weeks of Easter, how he went from persecuting the Christians to being one of its greatest apostles and evangelizers. The apostles themselves, these like regular Joes who are working their job way before the resurrection, after encountering Jesus, just to encounter him, made them leave behind their families, their jobs, their livelihoods, their lives. They ended up, most all of them ended up being martyrs. They gave up everything just from encountering this man before they saw any of his miracles. And now after the resurrection, they're set on fire, literally with those tongues of fire at Pentecost. We'll get there 50 days from now. And then they go out to the whole world preaching the good news that Jesus has risen from the dead. This man was not just another great prophet. He was way more than a nice guy. He was far more than a political leader who fought for social justice. He's all of those things, but he's God, most importantly. We remember all these great figures of the past, and they're buried in places, and we visit their burial sites, and they're in a lot of museums. But nobody has really altered their life or the history of the world because of them in a great of way as our Catholic Church has. And that's the other important thing, to remember that, yes, he is God. Yes, he came from heaven to earth. Yes, he died and promises resurrection to his followers. But to be his follower, we really have to follow him. It's not enough to just be a nice person. Lots of nice people out there. Dante said the road to hell is paved with priests, bishops, and nice people who had very good intentions. It's not enough to be nice. It's not enough to just do good works, right? We see in the scriptures, the rain falls on the bad and the good alike. The rain falls on the good and the good alike. But we have to follow Jesus. We have to take up our cross. We have to do what he says. And we have to follow in what he left behind with those 12 apostles, with the other brave women and men who went out amid the persecutions and continued to have masses celebrated in their homes, that continued to preach to all the nations, regardless of the kings and emperors who hated their message of love, that continued to go into new lands, that went with explorers and continued to discover the world, and went to these new peoples and preached to them who Jesus is, right? The same brave women and men that continue to start universities and schools and hospitals and orphanages, everything that the church has left us. It's not because of any one person, right? There's no one saint who saved the church. It's Jesus. That's who gave us the church. That is who is operating in the church. All the great saints that we venerate and we pray through would all point us to Jesus before themselves. That's why we don't have the church of Father Dominic, praise the Lord. We don't have the church of any one particular religious sister or brother. We don't have the church of any great layperson, right? We name them after saints. That's because in their saintly life, they led us to Jesus. He is who changes our life, literally, from dead to alive. And it's only to his faithful followers that we get eternal life. That's the message to bring home this Easter season. That it's good that we do the nice things, that we donate to charity, that we help out at soup kitchens, that we tutor kids who need help. It's good that we do those things. Those are good things. But they're not enough to get us into heaven. We have to follow Jesus. We have to give up our Saturday night at 8 p.m. to come and sit and worship. And even here, right, it's not about our beautiful singers, our wonderful lectors, or the beautiful flowers. It's always about Jesus. And if we can make our life all about him, we're going to be just fine. We won't have to worry about pandemics or job loss or homes closing or schools closing or parishes going away or people dying. None of that will truly matter in a life-changing way. That obviously those things matter. There's mourning and grieving and those feelings are real. So don't hear what I'm not saying. But our life will not be altered because of those changes. If we have Christ as our rock at the center, then when things change around us for good or for worse, we'll always have Jesus to hold on to. Anything else at the center of our life, that's what causes chaos. If my life revolves around my career, and then that goes away because of retirement, or the job goes away on its own, or whatever, if that was the center, now I have chaos. There's nothing to hold on to. Even if my life revolves around one person, whether that's a spouse, a significant other, a child, if our life is around one single person who's not eternal, then when they leave, either the relationship ends, they die, things happen. Life is in chaos. But if Christ, who is eternal, Christ, who is the light that scatters the darkness, if the Blessed Trinity, who has always existed and always will be, is at the center, then as those things change, there is no chaos. It's only an order. And then we can feel the appropriate feels, but know that Jesus is there, that we have a strong foundation, that we have the light within us. That's our Easter hope, our Easter message, friends. And let's take that out to the highways and byways and proclaim it loudly and proudly. Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. Alleluia. Alleluia indeed. Yeah.